For those of you who are writing an academic 5-paragraph essay, I wanted to spend a few minutes reviewing the first couple of weeks, things that we've talked about, things that we've been working on and completing in an effort to understand the topic, understand how we can narrow down the topic in such a way that it makes it appropriate for writing a 5-paragraph essay. So we're going to talk about the steps that we followed moving from brainstorming to an outline and all the steps in between and how they're related to each other. We started off brainstorming, reading academic peer-reviewed journal articles to try to find some sources and ways that we can narrow down our topic. We started off by listing out keywords that might relate to some kind of problem that we've experienced in the English language classroom. We created a word association, different words that relate to a topic that relates to a problem, something that we're interested in, and something, of course, that we can find articles on. We really need to make sure that we can find articles that, of course, it's something we're interested in, but it's also related to some kind of problem. So we started off brainstorming a list of words, and we talked as a whole group. We talked about some potential words that might relate to your own particular list. We talked about words like listening and speaking, reading, writing, grammar, vocabulary, pronunciation, learning strategies, communicative strategies, teaching techniques, materials, technologies, interactional patterns like working in pairs, working in small groups, autonomous learning, culture. These are just a few words that relate, that could relate to a topic. And again, the idea is to try to find a combination of words, not to use all of these words, but use enough of these in an effort to narrow down our topic. After we completed the brainstorming process, we started thinking about a problem statement, thinking about a one-sentence prompt that starts, "I wish to learn more about," and then we present a general topic. Because I want to know how, or I want to know why. This is our indirect question, where it begins, I want to know how something happens. I want to know why something happens. This indirect question is really at the root of our essay. That is, our essay sets out to answer one question. And that one question, at this point, is in the form of an indirect question. And then we continue with the prompt in order to, and then we introduce the significance. Think of the significance as the relevance of your indirect question, of your topic. What's the importance? What's the big picture? How might this help in a particular context where there's a problem? Think of your target audience. To whom are you writing your essay? Or maybe it's new teachers working in public schools. Maybe it's to parents, maybe it's to administrators. Think about the problem that you're addressing in your essay as to the relevance or significance. So again, our challenge here is to make sure that the indirect question is more specific than the topic. Even though it's an indirect question, notice that the problem statement itself is one declarative sentence. We will not have a question mark, even though in this case we do have inside this one sentence an indirect question. Now, once we have our problem statement, a good exercise here is to think about moving or converting the indirect question to a direct question. So again, we have, let's use this following example to see how this would work. Here's our example problem statement. I wish to learn more about assessing writing because I want to know how language teachers provide corrective feedback online throughout the writing process. In order to persuade language teachers who usually do not use technology, the utility of synchronous and asynchronous communication. So let's break this down. Notice that it is one declarative sentence. There are no question marks. but it is one declarative sentence. I start with an overall topic, assessing writing or writing assessment. This is a general overview. This is a general topic that relates to my essay. Alone, the topic is not enough, right? Because assessing writing is very general. Now I'm going to try to narrow down this topic in the form of an indirect question that reads, I want to know how language teachers provide corrective feedback online throughout the writing process. Now notice a couple of additional keywords that I've added to the indirect question that makes it more specific. I am talking about language teachers. Notice I haven't used English language teachers, so this could apply in general to any foreign or second language or any additional language. Notice I've added the term corrective feedback. Notice I've added the term online, and notice I've added the phrase throughout the writing process. So these are aspects of the indirect question. It makes it more specific when you compare the indirect question to the topic writing assessment. Then I've concluded with the prompt in order to, again, all one sentence, in order to. Now I've added the word persuade. So this is a persuasive essay. So I'm saying persuade language teachers who usually do not use technology. Notice I'm using a relative clause here to make my subject, the term language teachers more specific. So I'm focusing on maybe a potential problem with some language teachers not using technology. And I'm also introducing terms like synchronous and asynchronous communication, because perhaps that's also another aspect of my essay that I want to bring into the conversation, so that I am addressing a certain type of problem. The problem is implied here. The problem might read something like, certain language teachers, the problem is language teachers are not using technology in a way that best utilizes synchronous and asynchronous communication. This is the implied problem. And whenever you're writing a good significance, your job is to try to make the problem evident, to make it obvious, to make it clear, right, through the way that you're presenting the language. So here we have one declarative sentence, we have a topic, we have a more specific indirect question, followed by the significance. Now, once we have a problem statement, we're going to now think about the thesis statement and how the thesis statement relates to the problem statement. We're going to take the indirect question first, and we're going to convert it to a direct question. So again, the indirect question is, I want to know how language teachers provide corrective feedback online throughout the writing process. Now, the thesis statement, it's going to contain five things, but essentially it's there to answer this indirect question. It should begin with a transition, and we'll look at that here in a minute. But I want to look at the simplified version of a thesis statement and only focus right now on the topic or the subject and the opinion or the claim or the position or the point of view, the verb phrase. We're just going to look at that here as an example to see how the thesis statement relates to the indirect question that is embedded inside the problem statement. So we have our indirect question. I want to know how language teachers provide corrective feedback online throughout the writing process. I'm going to convert this first to the direct question equivalent. It's going to read, how can language teachers provide corrective feedback online throughout the writing process? Notice that if you compare the direct question to the indirect question, essentially, we're using the same words. We're just converting it to a direct question by changing the word order and adding the modal can. How can language teachers provide corrective feedback online throughout the writing process? This is the direct question that relates to the entire essay. Now, once we have the direct question that relates to the entire essay, now we can get into the thesis statement, starting off with a transition. Here's an example. To assist language learners with the most difficult skill, writing, comma. So this is transitioning from information or sentences that come before this thesis statement. So remember that the thesis statement is going to be located at the end of the introduction paragraph. We'll talk more in another video, more specifically about what we should include in the introduction paragraph. But imagine we have some sentences that's coming before the thesis statement, and imagine that we're talking primarily about the problem of, let's say, writing being one of the most difficult or being the most difficult of the four skills. Once we have our transition, now we're going to present the topic and the opinion or the subject, and now we're going to present a claim. And this is, again, where we're going back to the direct question and answering it almost word for word. So in our example, we're going to continue. Language teachers may provide corrective feedback online throughout the writing process. That is attempting to answer the question, how can language teachers provide corrective feedback online throughout the writing process? Language teachers may provide corrective feedback online throughout the writing process, almost word for word. I'm using the same language in my thesis statement that answers the direct question. Now, because I am answering a how question, I'm going to use the preposition by, followed by three key points that's going to later be developed in each of my three body paragraphs. So in this example, my first key point is going to read, by applying strategies for understanding the topic. This is my first key point. Notice I have a comma after the first key point. My second key point, using shared online spaces for drafting and revising the text. I'm going to use the serial comma to conclude my second key point. And my third key point, by employing an e-portfolio for publishing a text to the masses. There's a typo here. It should read an e-portfolio or electronic portfolio for publishing a text to the masses. I have here three key points that are going to later be developed in three body paragraphs. You're basically giving the reader at the end of the introduction paragraph an overview or an outline of what's coming up. Now, once we have our thesis statement, we are going to now develop an outline. Again, we're going to use our thesis statement, and we're going to focus specifically in the three key points that conclude the thesis statement. So we're going to list our thesis statement and our outline, and we're going to take our first key point in this example by applying strategies for understanding the topic. Now we're going to convert that to a topic sentence. So our outline is going to begin with the three topic sentences that are going to later begin each of the three body paragraphs. The topic sentence should be a complete sentence. It should be a declarative sentence that takes the key point from the thesis statement and state it again, but more specifically. How do we make it more specific? Adding phrases, adding adjectives, adjective phrases, adverbial phrases. We can add clauses. In this example, our first topic sentence could read, note-taking and search strategies help language learners find relevant articles about a problem of interest. Now notice I've taken some of the words from the key points. For example, the word strategies, I'm repeating that word again. And I've added, in this case, instead of just saying applying strategies, I'm being more specific by adding note-taking and search strategies. So the idea with this first body paragraph is that we're going to talk only about note-taking and search strategies. We're not going to talk about every possible strategy under the sun. We're going to focus on these two only. We're also going to focus on using these strategies to find articles about a problem of interest. Okay, so notice in the thesis statement, we just say understanding the topic, but more specifically, we're talking about understanding the problem of interest. Okay, so that's going to be the essence of the first body paragraph. Again, the topic sentence should be a complete sentence. It should be, have a subject and a verb. It should be a declarative sentence. And it should state more specifically what you've stated in the key point at the end of your thesis statement. Now let's take a look at the second key point, using shared online spaces for drafting and revising the text. Now here's a topic sentence that relates to that second point, but more specifically. Having a systematic way of leaving corrective feedback in an online Word document shared between teacher and student helps to maintain flow throughout the drafting and revising process. Again, look at the, notice the use of repetition, direct repetition. I'm reusing the words drafting and revising, both in the key point in the thesis statement as well as in the topic sentence, but I've added some more detail. Having a systematic way of leaving corrective feedback. So I didn't mention corrective feedback here, but I'm mentioning it in the second paragraph. In an online Word document, notice that instead of just saying online spaces, I'm saying online Word document, which basically I'm saying I'm only going to be talking about on an online space relevant to working in Microsoft Word. I'm not going to talk about any other ways of working online. I'm going to focus only on working online or in an online document. Shared between teacher and student helps, and then we're going to say something about flow through drafting and revising the process. The third key point, by employing an e-portfolio for publishing a text to the masses, third topic sentence reads, creating a personal and professional e-portfolio for publishing student work provides a purpose and broader audience for student work. So again, I'm using, to some degree, direct repetition. I'm repeating the word e-portfolio, and I'm repeating the word publishing. But again, my effort here in my topic sentence, my attempt is to be more specific by including or stating personal and professional e-portfolio. So I'm being more specific there. And I'm also using the word purpose and basically rewording the idea, publishing a text to the masses and being specific in terms of stating a purpose and saying to a broader audience, basically saying the same thing, but in a slightly different way. So notice here we have our thesis statement, we have our three topic sentences, and again, the idea with the outline is to make sure that our three topic sentences that later are going to begin our three topic or three body paragraphs align back to the thesis statement. That is, they are relevant, they are linked, and they're more specific. The topic sentences should be more specific than the ideas that are presented in the thesis statement. Now, once we have our topic sentences, our last step to complete our outline is to add evidence. So remember that the body paragraphs, we're writing an academic text which requires evidence, details, facts, statistics, examples that come from an outside source, in our case, coming from peer-reviewed journal articles, to support our topic sentence. So our outline at a glance should give us an idea of certain evidence that we found in our readings. And I would add the citation, according to APA 7th edition, to also be able to easily go back and find that information when it comes time to actually developing the body paragraph. But remember that the evidence here, the point is to make sure that at the end of the day, we have enough evidence to support each of our body paragraphs. We have enough evidence to support each of our topic sentences before we begin the writing process. Too many times students will begin the writing process, they will rush to trying to write out the first draft without not having read enough articles or without having found enough evidence to support each of those body paragraphs. And maybe they think, well, I'll do that later. But it, I think, leads to a more complicated process. It's more difficult, I think, once you start writing out that first draft, having to stop and go back and read more to try to find more evidence for one of your body paragraphs. So the point here, these first couple of weeks, is to keep reading throughout this whole process as we move from the brainstorming process to the problem statement, to the thesis statement, to the outline. This whole time, we should continue reading and modifying our problem statement and thesis statement as we need to until we feel like we have something that is something that we can write about, that we have articles, we have enough support, that's something that it's related to a problem, and of course it's something that we find that we're interested in and we find interesting. So our outline will conclude with our pieces of evidence. The evidence in this example that I presented here, I have two pieces of evidence to support each topic sentence. You might have more. Maybe you have just one piece of evidence. But notice here that even though I have evidence listed here, this is not a reference to how many sentences you should include. We'll talk about that when we discuss developing our body paragraph. At this point in our outline, the evidence should simply be words or phrases, something very brief, in your own words, but ideas coming from an outside source. Avoid copying and pasting evidence from an article to your outline. Again, put it in your own words, as this is a means of also better understanding these ideas that you're finding in your articles and bringing into your own writing. So paraphrase, put it into your own words. Include the citation. If it helps, you might even include the page number where you found the evidence so you can easily find it when you're going back to actually write the paragraph. But try to write out as many pieces of evidence as possible. You don't have to necessarily use all of the evidence when it comes time to writing the body paragraph. But again, this process will show that you have enough evidence before you begin writing your first draft so that you're sure that you have what you need to support your claims. So I hope this helps, guys, moving through the brainstorming process, the problem statement, the thesis statement, and then finally the outline. As we begin writing our paragraphs, I'm going to ask that you include at least 5 citations throughout your essay. And we'll need to have at least 1 citation in each paragraph with the exception of the conclusion paragraph. So we need to have at least 1 citation in the introduction paragraph and at least 1 citation in each of the 3 body paragraphs. Overall, we need to have at least 5 citations. So we might have 1 body paragraph with more than 1 citation, for example. All right, so I think we'll stop there, everyone, and we'll see everybody in class. We'll start talking more specifically about the body paragraphs and what we need to include in the introduction paragraph and the conclusion paragraph.